Thank you, everybody, for joining. My name is Mohammed Billoo. I'm an embedded Linux consultant and a Toradex technology partner. And today we're just going to provide an overview and a workshop on how to get started with machine learning using Toradex's Torizon and NXP's eIQ toolkit. So in this workshop slash webinar, we're just going to go over some of the tools that are available to us in our toolbox to help us get started in machine learning. We're not really going to do a real deep dive into the nuances of machine learning, like how to do it properly. That's reserved for a future webinar where once we have the available tools to us, then we can actually go into the nitty-gritty details on and see how adjusting different parameters, different implementations can affect the outcomes of the model that we're generating to actually do inference at the edge. And also a few housekeeping notes. One is if you have any questions, please put them in the chat window. Please note that they will be visible to everybody. It's not going to be private. So just be wary of that. And also a big shout out to Toradex. They've been tremendously helpful in organizing these webinars, providing feedback in terms of technical details, providing hardware as well. And it's been tremendous working with them throughout the course of our relationship. And I hope to continue that in the future. So this is the agenda for the webinar today. First, we're just gonna go over, as usual, the motivation and the requirements of what we're trying to accomplish. And then we're going to go over some of the tools that are available to us when we're trying to accomplish or when we're trying to do machine learning. That includes, of course, Toradex's Torizon ecosystem, TensorFlow, which is a really popular framework that's developed by Google to assist in performing training in machine learning as well as inference at the edge. Also, NXP's eIQ toolkit, which obfuscates a lot of the nitty-gritty details and provides a really nice UI for developers or for engineers to be able to develop machine learning models and to actually test them out and deploy them. And then finally, we're going to go over the actual demo, do a really simple walkthrough of these tools that are available to us, including TensorFlow on Google's own platform. And we're going to also, so we're going to use TensorFlow and NXP's eIQ to generate a machine learning model using some sample images that we have. And then we're going to actually deploy that model onto a device, onto a Toradex-based SOM and carry board that's running Torizon's ecosystem. And we're going to see how really the tools that are available to us are not that complicated. They actually make our life very, very easy, especially if you're going to see with the eIQ toolkit, the UI is pretty intuitive. It allows us to do the necessary steps in curating our data sets to do proper machine learning. And also, like Google's TensorFlow interface is also very straightforward. We're going to see how, with minimal lines of code, we can create a model very effectively, an effective model. And also, Toradex's Torizon ecosystem really enables us to deploy really efficiently and quickly containers that can actually perform the inference with a test image that we want to run. And we'll also see how this is actually having these tools that are available at our fingertips allows us to focus on the actual nuances and details of machine learning so that we can actually focus on what we're trying to accomplish. And we'll see actually with the model that we create that there are really important nuances that we have to be aware of when actually creating a machine learning model and deploying it. And we're going to see some of the deficiencies that exist when we try to deploy a very simple and really a naive model. So we're going to see that in the demo and walkthrough. We're going to go through some of these tools that are available to us and how to actually use them. And then finally, we're going to talk about what are some good next steps to focus on and go through. And then finally, we'll conclude with the question and answer. So a little bit about us. Like I said, I'm Mohammed Billoo. I'm founder of MAB Labs Embedded Solutions. You can reach out to us on our website and our LinkedIn. We are a Toradex technology partner. Our core expertise lies in Linux-based embedded and IoT systems. That includes board bring up, custom driver development, BSP customizations, and also we do bare metal or RTOS-based embedded software development as well. And recently we've gotten into application development. We've implemented solutions for networking systems, for image processing via OpenCV, as well as machine learning using TensorFlow. So we try to teach the community about the lessons that we learned through using the different tools and working on different projects. And so we hope that everybody can benefit from the lessons that we also learned. And if you're interested, you know, I highly recommend you sign up for our BIOS Food newsletter. We provide updates on latest developments on webinars such as this, courses that we're holding in the future, additional tips and tricks and news that are coming out in the embedded Linux and embedded software world. So I highly recommend everybody signing up for a newsletter. You can scan the QR code and it'll take you directly to the sign up webpage. So let's do a real quick overview of machine learning first, right? So machine learning is really simply put, right? You can imagine that computers and humans have a different way of approaching problems, right? So a computer can do really simple tasks really fast, really efficiently, whereas a human brain is not really trained or is not really capable of doing really simple tasks efficiently, but instead it can handle really monstrous tasks from a complexity standpoint really effectively. So what we're trying to do with machine learning is to apply the way that our brain operates to a computer. And so what that means is if you think about like the growth of a human, the development of a human being over the course of like many tens of years, right? For example, we're continuously training, right? Even a couple of years, right? We're from our birth, we're training, our brain is continuously training to learn about the environment surrounding us, right? And we're making decisions, we're learning from these decisions, and we're keeping a record of the results of certain decisions so that we can learn from this in the future. And so we're trying to apply the same sort of phenomenon to computers as well. And that becomes a little bit tricky because, like I said, computers are capable of handling really simple tasks, but doing it very efficiently. And so we have to break down the problem in a way that makes sense for a computer to handle. And so what we're trying to do with machine learning is we're trying to make sense of data that can capture similar phenomenon. So whether it be an image of, let's say, myself, right, in different environments with different features. For example, if I have a haircut, if I've lost or gained some weight, or we want to be able to use a computer to tell us that regardless of some really simple features that may vary here and there, an image captured of me is me effectively, right? And so we do that by generating massive amounts of data and using effectively what's like we try to implement the human brain via like in an artificial manner using something called the neural network and basically feed that data to this neural network and help it and tell it that, oh, you know, these pictures that you're seeing, for example, are of myself, and these other pictures that you see are not of myself. And so we do that to help this process along, to help the computer train itself and understand about what images that it's seen, for example, and make some generalizations. And so, like I said, we go through this iterative process where the computer basically starts fitting a model and developing a model based on the data that we provide. And it's And we can use a computer because, like I said, it can perform these really simple tasks very quickly, and it can quickly churn through data. So we can, what we're trying to achieve is basically turning years of development of a human being into, let's say, hours or days or even weeks for a machine to basically learn, right? So we're reducing that time frame pretty substantially. And machine learning is not something new. It's been around for some time. Data fitting or linear regression, or even logistical regression is an example of machine learning. What you're doing is you're taking a series of points and you're trying to see which curve best fits these data points, right? And so this has been around in Excel for some time and other platforms to allow you to perform this operation. And this is one really basic example of data of machine learning. Basically, you're trying to see in a really rudimentary fashion, if you take different curves and different parameters of different curves, which combination of curve and parameters gives you the best fit to a particular data point. And so in machine learning, there's two real operations that occur. The first is called training. And here is where we go through the process of educating the machine, of educating the computer. So we have really untrained computer with some really basic parameters that it has, right? So if you know what a neural network is, we have some really fundamental parameters that are associated with the neural network. And all we're doing continuously in training is just feeding data to this neural network, letting it basically learn from itself. We're just helping it along the way. We're telling it, oh, this image represents this thing and this image represents another thing. And we're feeding it images that represent the same object, for example, with really minimal nuances and minimal variations, and allowing it to learn from that and allowing it to generate a model, right? So if we go back to this example, what's happening is these points are really just data points that represent a particular image. And all we're doing is allowing the computer to generate an appropriate curve and also like get these appropriate parameters to match, let's say, a particular image that corresponds to a particular object. So training itself is computationally intensive. You do need computers that have GPUs or what are now like specific controllers or microprocessors that are really designed from the ground up at the transistor level to be able to perform these operations even more efficiently than a GPU. They're time consuming and they require massive amounts of data. And we're gonna see in the demo where if we try to apply a really naive, if we make a really naive attempt to training, we're gonna see that the actual model doesn't even work well on the actual data if we test it against it. So that's training. The other component of machine learning is inference. And here we already have a model, right? We went through the training process and we've already generated a model. And now we want to deploy somewhere, let's say on your phone, or let's say on a really IoT device, for example. And we take that model and we run it against data that's fed into this edge system or an IoT system, and it spits out a decision. And so this is not as computationally intensive as training. It's immediate. And we, instead of having this bank of data at our disposal to be to provide the computer, we're just basically, it's more or less a real-time system. We're gathering data and we're feeding it to this implementation to give us a final decision. So training and inference are two aspects of machine learning. So if we kind of look at what's state of the art right now, machine learning in 2022, training still requires substantial computational resources. Like I said, there have been massive developments in specialized chips, specialized microprocessors and devices that can speed up that process pretty substantially. And so it has gotten a lot better in terms of training. But we still need pretty beefy computers that can do the job for us. Let me see if there's. But inference, what's amazing now is that it can be performed at the edge, like I said, on IoT devices, on computational systems that don't have substantial resources. And this is really attributed to, again, even though we have, this can be attributed to a massive reduction in just manufacturing processes, right? So as transistors are getting smaller and smaller, we can pack in more transistors and devices onto a smaller area and they consume less power. So now we can actually put a GPU at the edge in relatively small form factors And a lot of these times, these GPUs are part of the system on the chip. So they're basically on the same piece of silicon where the CPU exists. And also, like I said, we have been introduced to these special controllers that can even, that are specialized. So if you know the history of a GPU, although it's been more recently used to do machine learning, its original use case was to do graphics, right? And so if you imagine, let's say a frame buffer that you want to display onto the screen, it's actually tons of data that the GPU needs to process. And so a GPU would actually be responsible for acting on a lot more memory than a CPU would be. And its inherent architecture is pretty different compared to a CPU. But now we've been, a lot of hardware companies have introduced these even more specialized devices that are that have been architected to perform machine learning. And these are referred to as NPUs, as neural processing units, or in the case of Google, they've introduced these tensor processing units or TPUs. So we're getting to the point where we have special processors that are designated and devoted to doing machine learning at the edge. And so that's why now a lot of machine learning inference tasks can be performed on really low power, small form factor devices that operate on the edge. Just some examples of machine learning at the edge in 2022. In the Pixel 6, a new technology has been developed where basically you can take an image and you can effectively erase out unwanted artifacts in the image that you've collected, and the machine learning system on the device itself will be able to remove the artifacts that you wanted to remove. So you don't really need a backend to do that for you. It's all being done on the device. There's very minimal transaction that's happening between the device and the cloud. Similarly, on the iOS side, a lot of the infrastructure is being moved onto the device itself in the name of security. So for example, Face ID, even Siri now is learning what you're asking of it on the device itself. There is no real or preferred communication to the backend, and Face ID, all the security features that are contained on the device are only relegated to the device itself. There is no real communication to the backend. And so a lot of the smartphone industry is moving a lot of this functionality to the edge itself because A, it provides a more secure and more timely solution for what they're trying to accomplish. Another example of machine learning at the edge. So this is kind of going back to my statement where a lot of the tools now are becoming a lot easier to use, and you don't need to understand too much about in terms of development. The implementation is pretty straightforward, and it's really the process. You have to go through the process and make sure that your data is representative and correct and diverse as well of what you're trying to detect. So here's an example. I'm pretty sure most of you are aware that there was a famous article where a Japanese cucumber farmer was using deep learning and TensorFlow to be able to distinguish between different types of cucumbers. So it's a testament to how far we've come along in terms of the tools and capabilities that are at our fingertips in performing machine learning. So let's go over some of the tools that are available to us. So let's start off with TensorFlow. So this is Google's framework that they've developed to help train and to help and perform training and inference for machine learning. So it's an end-to-end platform for machine learning. It can really do training, inference, and also deployment. It operates on multi-dimensional arrays. So it's what's referred to as a tensor, right? So if you imagine like a one-dimensional data structure would be a scalar, two-dimensional would be a vector, or two or three-dimensional would be a vector. And then multidimensional beyond that is what's referred to as a tensor. And so the point of the tensor is that you're trying to apply different features to multiple pieces of data in successive, in series, right? So you're generating a single data structure that can give you multiple pieces of information about similar pieces of data. TensorFlow also provides a collection of workflows to develop and train models. So they have, their framework is available in Python, C and C++, as well as JavaScript. So like I said, as with any real machine learning process, TensorFlow allows for three processes. The first is training, which is where you're developing that model. Then it's validation, where given the model that you have, now you're going to actually see how well it works. And then finally is deployment. TensorFlow also has what they refer to as Model 2, which is a collection of models that Google has pre-trained on massive amounts of data. So these are commonly used for, let's say, basic object detection. There's commonly available models that people normally use when they want to do just really basic object detection. And finally, TensorFlow Lite is one of the more popular frameworks to use at the edge. So basically, you have a pre-trained model. You deploy that model to perform inference at the edge. And then you use TensorFlow Lite to basically use that model, run it against some piece of data that you've captured, and give you an output on what that model has said is being observed by that piece of data. The other tool that's also kind of similar to TensorFlow is NXP eIQ. It's a machine learning software development environment. So it's really, and I guess you can call it an IDE, but it's a lot more than that. It gives you a really end-to-end perspective on how to basically going through the entire process of doing machine learning, whether it's training, and then you go to validation, and then finally to deployment to actually generate and use a model that you've created. It enables use of ML algorithms. So of course, because it's developed by NXP, they're mainly targeted for their own MCUs and MPUs. So the Edgeverse, for example, as well as the IMX RT MCU and the IMX MPU. And they offer a complete ML workflow tool. So you, like I said, you can do everything from training all the way to validation as well as deployment. And it leverages open source and proprietary technologies. It's fully integrated into NXP's Yocto project development environment. So the toolkit itself, it is an intuitive GUI that was developed in partnership with AUZone. So that's a company that developed a really innovative project, a product called the Maven, which provides a complete hardware software solution for end-to-end embedded IoT edge-based computer vision and machine learning. So the toolkit simplifies ML-based solutions, really targeting computer vision. So as we're gonna see in the demo, we basically feed it images and then we label them. And then we go through the training process to generate a model, and then we can export that model for deployment onto the device, right? So that is used by TensorFlow. Okay. So this is just an example of the process on using the eIQ toolkit. So in this particular demo, we're gonna be focusing on the left side, where we're gonna be providing our own images, we're gonna be importing them, we're going to label them, and then we're going to segregate the images for training and testing. We're going to train the model and then validate and then deploy. But also you can bring your own model that you've developed. You can make some minor tweaks here and there, and then you can see how well that your tweaks work with actual images as well. So and then finally you can actually deploy it and then perform the inference at the edge. Okay. So the last framework that we want to talk about is Toradex's Torizon. It's a complete ecosystem, and it allows you an organization to maintain all of their devices and manage and perform OTA updates from development to deployment, right? So you can be an individual engineer that's performing development, And then you can be testing on your device itself. And then once you're ready, you can deploy it to, let's say, a system test team. They can deploy it on their own devices, run the regression testing. And then once they've approved the release, it can be pushed out to devices in production. And so all of that is pretty much handled in the Torizon ecosystem. They have a really innovative and simple web interface to not only allow remote deployments of complete images, but also give you visibility of the different devices that are basically out in the field and really anywhere. And Torizon supports different degrees of modification. So at the really lowest level, you can modify the kernel itself and the entire operating system image itself for, let's say, custom hardware. So it is based on the Yocto project. And so if you understand how to navigate and make adjustments to a particular board support package in the Yocto project, then you're well prepared to make similar modifications to a Torizon base image. And then once you have that Torizon base image, again, you can use the web interface to deploy it other devices that are out in the field. So if you go one step above that and you don't really need to make these low level modifications to support custom hardware, Torizon inherently uses Docker as the basis for application development. And what's great about Docker is that you don't need to really manage the nuances of how individual services and applications are being loaded. It's really abstracted out to Docker. And as long as you have the Docker daemon running, then it's really just a matter of loading the individual containers and running them and then configuring them to be run at launch. And the other cool thing that Docker allows for is a really quick and efficient development process cycle. You can develop applications on a native PC using the standard, like a Docker container that's running on an x86 machine. And also you can test it for ARM as well. So Docker inherently supports ARM emulation. And so even though you've developed your application on an x86 PC, you can actually test it as if it were running on an ARM system. And then once it's ready to go, there's minimal to no effort to actually just porting that application to the target hardware. It's really just a matter of figuring out how to deploy it. And then with Torizon, the deployment process is also handled for you. And like I said, the web interface allows you to perform deployments of complete images to remote devices that are out in the field. And then one of the great things about Toradex is that they have an excellent support community. They're really responsive on their community forums. Their documentation is tremendous. And like I said, their responsiveness on their community forums is one of the best that I've personally seen. So some of the advantages of using Torizon. So going from, let's say, development perspective, Visual Studio Code and Visual Studio are one of the popular IDEs that are used nowadays. And so the great thing about Torizon is that it integrates really nicely into these two IDEs. There's an extension available that allows you to deploy your Docker containers and your applications to a device that's on your network. There is no real need for a CLI. And it also integrates really nicely with Docker Hub. So you can pull down containers that are readily available on Docker Hub. And the major programming languages are supported, such as C and C++, Python and .NET. So it provides a really efficient mechanism and interface to perform development for your applications. And once you, let's say you go from deployment from development to deployment, Torizon offers solutions as well to make sure that you're well aware of how your fleet is operating and how your devices out in the field are functioning. So device monitoring is available so that you can gain valuable insight into not only performance of individual nodes, but also of basically your entire network. The web interface makes, like I said, device provisioning very easy. All you have to do is run a command on the device once it's ready for deployment, and the backend simply picks it up. And then not only that, but you can assign these devices into different groups and fleets so that you can segregate what devices get certain updates. So for example, if you have a device that's for development, another set of devices that are for, let's say, a system test team, and then a third set of devices that are for production that are out in the field, you can easily go through the process of doing application development deployment on individual devices for, let's say, a developer, developing on devices that are for the system test team, and then finally deployment on devices that are in production. So the interface and the entire ecosystem makes that process very streamlined and seamless. Like I said, you can also deploy images locally during development as well, so that the process of iterating as you see changes and as you, let's say, identify bugs and you want to see and confirm that your bugs are actually resolved, you can quickly deploy an image locally on your development system as well. So like I said, we can, with Torizon, we can customize a single image as much as possible. So we can have multiple Docker containers that are running on a single image via Docker Compose. That can be used to create containers for different applications that can be running on a single system. And like I said, we can customize the base image as well. So if you want to get into the nitty-gritty of the kernel, and customize your operating system for different pieces of hardware, Torizon is based on the Yocto project and Open Embedded. So if you're comfortable doing development there, then modifying and customizing a standard Torizon image is not that big a deal, right? So let's kind of get into it now. So this is a rough overview of kind of what we're going to demo, what we're going to kind of demonstrate today. So first, we're just going to start simple, right? We're going to take a Docker container that we have that's running on an Apalis, a Toradex Apalis SoM and carrier board, and we're going to pass a standard image that's of Grace Hopper, who's the famous computer scientist who developed numerous computer science innovations, and we're going to run it through a standard TensorFlow-like model. This model has been created by Google, where they fed through tons and tons of images and labeled them and provided them and output a model that is commonly used for basic object detection. And then we're going to, so once we have that and we've determined how to go through that process, we're going to slowly build up. So then we're going to walk through the training process via NXP's eIQ toolkit. So in this particular use case, this demo is really meant to show these tools. The actual process that we're going to go through is, we're going to see, is actually pretty naive, because we only captured about 100 images. So the process is really, the objective is, we're going to feed in images of myself, like different images in different scenarios, and we're going to basically label them as myself, and we're going to generate a model from that. And so we're going to see that that's not actually a good way to perform machine learning, because we don't have that many data points. So we only have 100 or so images. And not only that, we're only training the machine learning model for a single, what's called label, right? So we're just saying, oh, this image is of Mohammed. We don't have any other images that are representative of not Mohammed. So there's no way for the machine learning model to be able to correct itself, because it's only referencing a single set of labels. But we're just here to see kind of that process go along. Like, we're going to see like how that actually, how the model actually doesn't work too well. And we're going to kind of speculate as to, you know, like I said, like why it doesn't work. And it's going to be because we didn't really apply the best practices of machine learning, which is something we can go through in a future webinar. And so once we have that, we're going to, but what we can do is we can run this pre-captured image of, so we're gonna Once we generate this TensorFlow Lite model using eIQ, we're going to do two things. One is we're going to run one of the images that we use to train the model against the model itself. And we're going to see like that, even that doesn't work too well. Again, because our model is not sufficient. And what we're also going to do is going to, we already have a pre-captured image that's not of the data set that's used to generate the model. And we're going to run it through the model again, and again, see that it again, doesn't work too well. The third thing that we're going to do is run the pre-captured image through like the standard TensorFlow Lite model. Again, this is running through Google's own object detection model where they've gone through many, many images. And we're going to see that the model is able to detect with certain confidence that some images, certain objects are present in the image. And then finally, we're just going to go through the process in generating the model again in Google's own Colab infrastructure and framework. All right. So let's kind of get into it. So the first thing we're going to do is going to use, and so this is NXP's eIQ framework system. And so I already have a project that I've created. So typically you would go through the process of creating a project and then you would import your data set. So I've already done that. So and this is a testament to basically the process of machine learning. So the theme behind this webinar and this workshop is that the tools to generate the model and the process to generate the model is not the most time consuming. The biggest time sink in performing any machine learning model like system is getting appropriate data sets, right? So you want to get data sets that are representative of not only, so in this particular case, like I have images of myself throughout the years, right? Of in the past, in different lighting conditions, I have some sunglasses on here and there, you know, different times of day. And so even this, right, and I have only 167 images, right? So typically in a typical machine learning process, the number of images, for example, is a lot more, is on the order of thousands, right? And not only that, but typical machine learning processes, you would want to see different types of images. So the problem here is that I only have images of myself. Ideally, I would have images of other people or of other things to tell the model that, hey, you know, this is somebody else. So if we kind of click on one of these images, we'll see that, right? So I labeled this as MAB, as myself, right? So ideally, all of these images, all of these images are labeled as MAB. So the problem is that when we go to actually run create this model, we don't have anything that is representative of anything else in this model. And so this model is not going to perform that well. But you know, this is kind of just demonstrating the process of going through the, like using this tool as well. And so we're gonna see something similar with TensorFlow. So next step is once we have the data set. So like I said, so here we have labels. So what you need to do in a particular label in the process is for each image. And again, like I said, these are actually what I had to do is for each of these images, I had to crop my face out and then apply label to each of these images. So now if I had thousands of images, that process is pretty cumbersome and time consuming. So this is kind of to hit home the theme that in a lot of machine learning workflows, this is the most time consuming and probably arguably the most important process because you need to make sure that your data is valid, it's representative of what you're going to feed the model into. And not only that, but you need diversity, right? So in a lot of training machine learning workflows, you'll see like, you won't see a single label. You will see like multiple labels and you'll see hundreds, if not thousands of images that are representative of that particular label because that's, that just helps to improve the accuracy of your model. Okay. So, and not only that, but you'll see that I've also separated out the number of training models and testing models. So the general workflow for performing machine learning is you divide up your objects or your images, your pieces of data, for example, into two sets of categories. One is what you're actually training the model for, and then the next and the other set is what you're going to test your model against. So it should be pretty, it should work pretty well. And so the next step is once we have that, so we want to select the model. So there's two sets of, there's two types of models that we can run. One is either detection, where basically you you have an image that has a lot going on, or it has a particular image, and you want it, the model to pick out the draw bounding box around the item or around a particular object that has been detected. Or you do classification where you have an image that is really specific. So generally what this requires is you're doing some pre-processing even at the edge. So you're doing some sort of, let's say, OpenCV if you're doing face recognition, and you're cropping out the image you're cropping out the image so that it's only representative of what you want to classify. Whereas with detection, there can be more things that are going on in the image, and you really want the model to be able to pick out within the image a particular object that has been detected. So in this particular case, we're going to select classification, and we can have different options. So there's one option for performance optimization where it's going to perform inference with the least amount of time, but the accuracy is not going to be that great. There's going to be there's the balanced option where it strikes a good balance between performance and accuracy. And then finally, there's the accuracy option, which inference may take some more time, but it's going to give you the best result. So in this particular case, we'll pick balanced. And then additionally, we can select different we can select different processors that we want to target towards. So in this particular case, because I'm running a variant of the Palace Toradex SoM that doesn't support an NPU, ideally we'd want to support an NPU, which would be much faster in terms of inference than a GPU. But in this particular case, I'm going to select the GPU. So now we go through, so we've selected all the images that we want to train and test against. We've identified the labels. And so we want to go through the actual process of training. And so to do that, we basically, since we've already have things set up, all we really need to do is start training. So here are some options and parameters that we can adjust. So these are typical machine learning parameters. So the cool thing about eIQ is I appreciate the fact that these are available to us. We're going to see with TensorFlow when we actually use it in Google's Colab, that a lot of these parameters are hidden to us. But in this particular case, we can adjust these parameters and see how that affects a model. Now, what you're going to see here is that our accuracy is going to be 100%, and really adjusting these parameters doesn't have an impact. And the reason is, again, because our data set is not the greatest that we've selected. We need to do a better job in selecting the appropriate data set, and only then will some of these results kind of start making more sense. So we start the training process. And this, of course, like I said, like this process just inherently takes a substantial amount of time. But in this particular case, again, because we have only 100 or so images, it takes on the order of minutes. So we're already done. And then we can see that and an epoch is really, in machine learning jargon, it's the number of times that we're feeding data sets into the same neural network. And so we're letting it kind of learn itself. And the batch size is for a particular iteration of the neural network, how much data do we feed into it? So in this particular case, we let it run for one epoch, right? And we basically, we're getting 100% accurate. So again, this is because we haven't fed it any images that are not of myself, right? So this is one deficiency of this particular process, is that we went through we only gave it images that are representative of a single, what's referred to as a label, right? Ideally, we would want to feed it more images that are representative of different labels as well. So now, so one thing that I'm actually working with NXP on is this validation process. When we go through this process, it for some reason it throws an error. So I'm going to skip this process. But the cool thing is I'm working with NXP and AU Zone to resolve these issues, and they're very responsive in this matter. So the next step is deploy. And so in this particular case, we're going to just select TensorFlow Lite, and all we're going to do is just export the model, right? And then we can select where we want it to be. So again, the point of this exercise is to show that actually creating the model, going through that process, adjusting these parameters here, right, is pretty straightforward, right? There isn't much infrastructure or tooling that you have to set up. And you, adjusting a lot of these parameters is very straightforward. The actual big challenge comes along with curating data, making sure that you have an appropriate diversity of data that's correctly labeled, you have diverse labels. So now let's go to the edge, right? So here, we're going to SSH into my palace SOM. Go in. There we go. So there's a couple of things here. So one is we have, like I said, a lot of with Torizon is accomplished. A lot of the operations and applications in Torizon are implemented using Docker containers. And again, because it allows you to develop applications in a really neat sandbox. And makes it independent of anything else that you're doing. So the applications themselves can be run, and you have all of your dependencies here so that you don't need to worry about reproducing a system between one, reproducing a configuration across systems. And so here we have a really, it's a really involved Docker container. And the big thing is really, we only have to just set up the appropriate libraries to run TensorFlow Lite. And so here it's really just setting up Python interfaces to C libraries or to C applications, functions, installing Python dependencies, as well as TensorFlow dependencies, as well as, so here's the key thing here as well. Because we want to be able to leverage the GPU that's on the system, we want to be able to run what's called a delegate, right? So the delegate is really the interface between the CPU and the GPU that allows us to increase the or improve the performance of our inference at the edge, right? Because if we were to use it on the CPU, it's not going to be as efficient as running it on the GPU. Okay, so like I said, a lot of it is really, and then we're going to make this available, this Docker container, this Docker file, and then we'll post a link to the actual Docker file itself, that you can run and reproduce this setup yourself. And so the first thing that I want to do is just run this container. And so I have, as one of the simple things that we want to do is we want to go into like the standard examples that TensorFlow Lite provides to us. And what we want to do is we want to run this label image Python application, right? And all it's doing is it's feeding, it's going to input this mobile net TensorFlow Lite model. Again, this is something that Google has developed, feeding the neural network, the machine learning model, tons and tons of images of different objects, labeling these objects appropriately, and then creating a model out of that, right? So all we're gonna do is we're going to specify, this is the model that we wanna use, and we wanted to detect objects or label objects in this image of Grace Hopper, right? And so if we kind of pull this up, right? So this is gonna be, right? So this is going to be the image that we're going to feed into the inference engine, okay? So, and also the other key thing is this file, this text file called labels. And so this consists of all of the objects that this TensorFlow Lite model has knowledge of, right? So all the possible things, that the model is aware of and it's been trained to detect. So this, if we look at it, right? So this is basically a ton of objects, right? That Google has trained this model for, has trained this model to, for detection of these different objects. So we can see it's pretty extensive. And in our case of the images of the model that, that I've generated in the naive sense, like this is just going to be a single line, right? It's just going to be the label that is just represented of me. And again, this is to demonstrate that machine learning, the workflow itself is not really at a really high level, it's not really in the training of the model itself. It's really of the data collection, the data curation, making sure that you have variety of data, diverse data in different elements and of different labels, right? So that's more important than actually creating the, like adjusting the parameters of the model itself, like up to a certain point. So once you get past that certain point, then and let's say you have a pretty decent model, then it's really it may be a matter of adjusting these parameters to get a little bit more performance or accuracy. But also, like at the end of the day, one of the fundamental mantras about machine learning is it's really just about data, right? As whoever can get the most data, the most diverse data, the different most different data is going to get the ideal and the perfect model. So in this particular case, we're going to see this in action for like a standard image. So we're going to feed it this bitmap file, and we're going to run this model, and we're going to give it this text. And then also, we need to tell it of this delegate to basically use the GPU that's on board, right? And so when we run this, right, so we can see that there's some initial warm-up time, and this is common. You need the GPU or the entire system to be able to just get up to speed to make sure that it's ready to run. And we can see that the warm-up time took about a second, a little over a second, but then once it was warmed up, inference only took 12 milliseconds. And we can see that this is basically, outputting the results corresponding to a particular label. So there was a high degree of confidence in the image that a military uniform was detected, right? So it was about 87% a level of confidence that a military uniform was detected, a 3% level of confidence that a Windsor tie was detected, 1% confidence that a mortarboard was detected, and so on and so forth. And so this is basically like the fundamental kind of like running a standard image of that's most commonly used to demonstrate kind of machine learning. Like, okay, here's a sophisticated model that is commonly used. Here is the like a standard image that's used, and here's the output that generates. And so one of the key things here is though that because this is using a GPU, right, we can even get faster inference times if we were to use a device that has an NPU. So one of the other Apalis device lines that has the quad plus on it, so mine only has the quad max on it. Mine doesn't have an NPU on it, but other variants of the device that do have an NPU, like this inference time goes even lower, right? So this kind of demonstrates the power that specialized controllers and processors can bring to performing machine learning inference at the edge. Okay, so that's step one. So now we've taken just a standard image, run it through the mobile net application, run it through the mobile net model, and then seeing like how well, like what was detected from that model. So now we're going to go back, and so we're going to do a couple of things. So one is, this is kind of the a model that I've pre-generated using NXP eIQ, and this was basically through like using the most accurate setting in an eIQ. And again, this is my labels file, right? So again, this is a really naive model. We're going to see that it actually fails to detect anything, Because again, I didn't go through the correct workflow in generating a machine learning model, right? Ideally, like I've said, I would have a lot more images, a lot more diverse images of people that are not me, so that the machine learning model can also pick up, can distinguish between something that isn't me and then apply that and basically correct itself, right? So it knows what's representative of me and what's representative of not me. And so here, actually, so one thing we're going to try to do is, all right, this is an image that is actually in the training set itself. And we're going to see like, okay, what happens if we run it through, if we run this image through our model. So we're going to take this model, we're going to pass it this JPEG file and then see what just what happens, right? So and we always have to give the delegate to speed it up. Okay. So I have some debugging here. And also we can see that the inference time and the warm-up time went down because we already kind of ran like the warm-up previously. And we can see what happened is that the Python script said, oh, I actually didn't find anything that fit this model. I couldn't label this atom. So that's the error that we're seeing here. Basically, we're trying to see what was the result similar to this, but because the model is insufficient, we weren't able to get any result. So we can kind of learn from this that the model itself, again, the process of getting an appropriate model really is dependent on your data itself, the data that you're inputting. If you're not inputting sufficient number of images or sufficient number of labels or files with different diverse conditions, your model is not going to work as well. So in here, we can see that we actually like did very, very poorly. We couldn't even detect an image that we trained the data set on, right? So the next thing we're gonna do is, but again, the point of this webinar is really just to get started, right? It's really to understand the tools that are available in our tool belt, not only for training, but also for inference, right? And how that process really takes place, how both processes take place, both on the edge and let's say in the cloud where we're doing the training process. So the last step that we're going to do now is actually go through Google's own TensorFlow process, right? So this is Google's own framework called CoLab. And so this is really just a sandbox that lets you kind of play around with really just creating models like running Python scripts. This is really just a virtual machine that you can run your own models, create your own models to run your own data through and perform the process. So here what I have is, I have basically TensorFlow Lite, the model generators kind of set up. And the important thing here is that the structure, the directory structure is important. So here I have my images and then so I have a directory. So each directory under images contains images that correspond to a particular label. So previously, if you remember in NXP eIQ, I marked individual images as a label, as label map. But in this particular case, I've placed all of these images under this particular directory, right? So that, because that's how inherently the framework works. So if we kind of go up one level, and we see this Python script, we kind of quickly go through it. And the amazing thing that to me anyways, and this also goes to the eIQ toolkit, is that it's really simple. And it kind of hammers the lesson again, that the implementation, the process to train is really opaque to us, right? Like we don't really necessarily like at a high level have to write too much code to train. Instead, the majority of the process is really in collecting, curating appropriate sets of data. Okay, so here it's very simple. If you're knowledgeable of Python, like it's all we're doing here is importing the appropriate libraries, making sure that we have a particular version of TensorFlow, and we're generating a path that represents all the images. And so this actually points to the top level directory that has all of the labels in their individual buckets, right? Individual directories. So again, we only have a single label, right? We only have the label that corresponds to myself, and that's located under this images directory. And then here we're just loading all of these images into this data structure, right? And what we're doing here is we're telling TensorFlow that, oh, so now that you have all of these images, I want you to split it up such that 90% of them are used for training, and then the rest 10% are used for testing. So this kind of goes back to the validation process. So again, ideally, we would have more images that are representative of different sets of labels. So in the canonical example that Google has on their website for image recognition, they actually have different categories of flowers, and they have I think hundreds or thousands of images of different types of flowers, like tulips, roses, et cetera. And so they're doing this process on a lot more data than I am. And then finally, we're gonna actually create the model, right? And we're gonna create the model using the data that we've allocated for training purposes. And then we're gonna get some metrics based on evaluating the model against the test data. So again, we've split up our data into a training set and a test set. We've used the training data set for actually generating the model. And then for the test data, we're going to generate the loss and accuracy metrics. And then finally, we're going to, again, export a TensorFlow-like model to the directory itself. So if we run this, it's going to take a few minutes. So here we can see the actual process. So now it's doing 5 iterations into the neural network, and we can see, right, similar results to what we saw in NXP eIQ, where our loss is actually pretty insignificant and our accuracy is 1. So this is like, you make things like, oh, you have great accuracy in training your model, but this is actually bad. We want it to actually learn from its mistakes, right? So we don't want it to always so it's generally referred to like as we don't want it to only know about the good results. We also want the model to know about the bad results as well. And so this is, like I said, a naive implementation of a particular model. In a better scenario, in a better workflow, we would have massive amounts of data with a lot more images, and again, a lot more labels that are representative of different sorts of images, so that we can tell, we can reinforce to the model that, okay, this is pictures of myself, these are pictures of somebody else or not myself. So at least we have that binary decision to allow the model to kind of correct itself. And so we can see that, again, the TensorFlow Lite model was created, right? So here we're gonna kind of go through that process again. We go back to here, but this time we're going to use the model that was created. So we already have it stored here. This is at the edge, and we're gonna perform inference using this model that was created in CoLab. Whoops. Okay. And so again, we run into the same issue where we weren't able to detect any labels in the image that we actually trained the data with. So again, this is a testament to our model not being good at all, because again, we didn't provide enough data to train the model with, and enough labels so that we can perform any sort of reinforcement learning. Ideally, we would have different labels representative of different images so that the model can basically learn of things that are not representative of my image, of my face. But one last thing we could try is like, okay, what happens if we give it the model, right, of like we used in the Grace Hopper example, right? What if we use the model of that Google has provided, right? That's that they've trained with a ton of things. Can it actually pick up anything? So this is examples, right? So even here, it seems like it can't even detect what's going on. So let's try another image. Oh, because we didn't give the labels. All right, so we need to give it. Okay, so again, there wasn't much confidence. So this image is of really me with like a winter coat on, like skiing. So there was some confidence. I don't have a ski mask actually in that image. And so it had some degree of confidence that it detected like a ski mask in the image, some sunscreen, a bow tie because of like the way the image, my jacket is. Potentially it could represent a bow tie. But again, like this wasn't the greatest set. This wasn't using the greatest model for detecting objects in the image itself. So let's try the other image. So let's try this image. So this is really with me basically like in my office, taking an image with a webcam with equipment behind me. And again, like for it really just detected that there's a 13% level of confidence that there's a toilet seat behind me, which there isn't, stethoscope and a lab coat, a suit and a syringe. So again, like this was a testament to that the accuracy of a model is really dependent on the data that you're feeding into it. And you want to make sure that you have an appropriate set of data with the correct set of labels and also diverse labels, right? So we kind of went through the process of seeing that the workflow itself is pretty straightforward. We've gotten to the point where there's different tools and frameworks that can allow us to train models effectively and quickly. But again, the biggest challenge in any sort of machine learning workflow is data collection and data curation. And so, you know, I think that's the lesson that we want to take away from this webinar is that curation and collection are really key in making sure that your model is accurate. Otherwise, you know, it's just a matter of garbage in, creating garbage out, right? Like you're, even on data, as we saw, even on data that we've actually used to create the model, inference is not at all successful, right? It just failed to detecting anything. So just to recap on what we went through, we went over a brief review of machine learning, the concepts and tools and frameworks. So like I said, this was just getting started, right? So this was just going through like, okay, just getting comfortable on what tools are out there. How do you actually go through the training process, whether it be using NXP eIQ, which is more of a UI-based interface, or whether you use Google's Colab, or whether you do it on a native machine yourself, right? There's multitude of tools out there that you can use to perform training. And also for inference, what are some of the best practices that you want to follow, right? So using a Docker container to make sure that you obfuscate any sort of system level configuration differences and discrepancies to make sure that that there isn't any sort of dependency that you need to implement in a particular system to perform inference at the edge, right? So it's basically agnostic to really any sort of hardware that exists, right? So you can also include the capability that if, let's say, an NPU is existent on the system, to leverage that NPU, or if a GPU is present but not an NPU, then leverage the GPU, or if neither, then use the CPU as the fallback, right? So using a Docker container can allow you to accomplish that. And also this is done through Toradex Torizon, right? So using Docker containers in a Torizon ecosystem can allow you to develop an ML inference solution at the edge and deploy it as well. And so some of the next steps that I think are pretty obvious are that, you know, we need to kind of go into a deep dive into understanding, like, why are the results that we got when we created this model using images of myself with labels of with a single label, right? Why did it fail so spectacularly, right? What can we do to improve that process and to give us a better machine learning model? So at a minimum, if we use data or if you use an image that we use to train the model, that it actually gives us a proper result and it doesn't just fall flat on its face, right? So going through that process is one of the next steps. But again, this was just kind of getting started. Like, what are the tools and frameworks that are out there that can help us go through that process, not only on training, but also inference at the edge as well. So hopefully in the next webinar or workshop, we can understand, like, okay, what does it take to actually develop a proper model? And what is the workflow that's associated with there? So I thank you for signing on for this webinar. I hope it was helpful. I hope you took away that the tools and the frameworks that you can use to get started on your machine learning journey. And hopefully you get better results than I have in with the data that I've used. So now, if you have any questions, feel free to add them into the chat. Okay, and if anybody else has questions, I guess we can unmute everybody and they can just ask their questions. So one question is, what's the, a great question, what's the advantage of using Torizon versus any other embedded Linux software? So Torizon reduces your go-to-market pretty substantially, right? You don't have to, the base BSP that's available to you is pretty well developed and curated to allow you to run with hardware and peripherals that are very commonly available, unless you're running something really specific or really custom. And it still allows you to make that, allows you to customize the base image as well. And then you can kind of build up from there. And so you have both extremes of where you can do very minimal customization, whether it be just on the application, you just want to include your Docker containers in a singular image and then deploy it out to your entire fleet, or you need to go into the OS level and you need to make fundamental operating system Linux customizations for hardware. But then again, you can easily, once you have that image, Torizon lets you seamlessly deploy into the rest of your fleet. So all of that is pretty streamlined. We actually had a previous webinar where we kind of demonstrated how easy that process is in using Torizon, whether it be to create a custom kernel module and then include that into a Torizon image and then easily deploy that onto different devices of actually different pieces of hardware too, right? So that's the advantage, where whether it's very minimal changes or really involved changes, that entire process of making the change and deploying it is pretty well streamlined when it comes to Torizon. Great question. Anybody else have any other questions? What hardware spec should I search in a module to run machine learning in a Toradex SoM? So I think the biggest thing would be to, I don't think, so when you're doing machine learning inference, right, if I would say, make sure you like look for something that has GPU, I think. And like number one is MPU, the quad plus, the IMX8 quad plus variants of Toradex SoMs have an MPU. So if you can procure those, like I would say get those because they offer the best performance. If not, then use a GPU. RAM really doesn't come into consideration unless you have to use like something that has neither a GPU or an NPU. And I think even then, it's not really like TensorFlow Lite is optimized to use some of these specialized controllers. And I don't think it's really dependent on RAM. So I really focus on using an NPU or a GPU. Another great question, do we have any performance loss by running machine learning applications from inside a container like we do in Torizon Core? No, there is minimal, if any, performance loss, right, in running machine learning applications from inside a container because there is no emulation, right? It's just you're running directly on the bare metal, you're running on the hardware itself, the processor is executing, there is no translation layer. The processor is executing your instructions as it would natively. It's really just a matter of segregating. It's really just a matter of segregating different pieces of memory across different containers so that you have your essential, you have your a separate sandbox for you to work on. Cool, great question. Anybody else have any more questions? I don't think, so another great question is, Torizon Core uses Docker containers on the workflow. How do you think containers impact the machine learning performance? Like I said, I don't think there's any impact on performance because again, you're running directly on the hardware, right? There is no emulation. For example, in the examples that we saw, when we used the delegate to run inference on the GPU, you're not doing any sort of emulation to run on the to emulate a GPU. You're running directly on the GPU and the delegate is responsible and it's actually running directly on the CPU. The delegate is responsible for handling at a hardware level, the communication between the CPU and the GPU. So there is no performance impact on running a machine learning application in a Docker container on Torizon Core. Great question. Anybody else? Have any other questions? Yeah, if nobody else has any other questions, I once again would like to thank everybody that participated. I hope it was insightful. I hope you got a flavor of what the general process is in the machine learning workflow and how like the tools that are available, NXP eIQ, TensorFlow for training purposes, and of course for inference, like how Torizon and Toradex's Torizon Core and Torizon can enable really efficient machine learning applications at the edge. And finally, I'd again like to thank Toradex for being a tremendous partner. They've made these webinars and these workshops really fun for me, and their support has been tremendous. And I hope to see you in a future webinar where we can talk about this topic and or other topics that are exciting. So once again, thank you everybody for participating. The link to the recording will be made available. And like I said, the Docker file that contains the container that has a container that you can run inference at the edge will also be made available. You can subscribe to Toradex's newsletter or BIOS feed, MAB Labs' newsletter, and you'll get notification of when those are available for your consumption. So thank you everybody. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.